Hello, this is Helen Motti, and I want to welcome you to For Eternity.
I put my heart in your hands and you taught me to fly.
Hebrews 13, verses 1 to 3 exhorts us to let brotherly love continue. Do not forget to entertain strangers, for by so doing, some have unwittingly entertained angels. Remember the prisoners as if chained with them, those who are mistreated, since you yourselves are in the body also. For the past almost 4 years, Syria has increasingly dominated both the media and the world political stage. Covering an area that has experienced many invasions and occupations over the centuries, from Romans and Mongols to Crusaders and Turks, it was at one time the centre of the Islamic Empire. It is a land of contrasts, of high mountains, deserts, and fertile plains, and many diverse religious and ethnic groups make their home there. These include Kurds, Assyrians, Druze, Armenians, Alawite, Shia, Christians, and Arab Sunnis. The majority of the Muslim population are made up of Arab Sunnis. In 1946, modern Syria gained its independence from France, and since then, because of the conflicting interests of these diverse ethnic and religious groups, has endured periods of political instability. A BBC report of October 8, 2012 stated, "The government deals harshly with domestic opposition. Tens of thousands are estimated to have been killed in the suppression of the 1982 uprising of the Muslim Brotherhood in Hama." Following the death of Hafez al-Assad in 2000, Syria underwent a brief period of relaxation. Hundreds of political prisoners were released, but real political freedoms and a shake-up of the state-dominated economy never materialized. In 2011-12, security forces used tanks, gunfire, and mass arrests to try to crush anti-government street protests inspired by the Arab Spring in Tunisia, Egypt, and Libya. These protests rapidly took on a more formal nature when the opposition began to organize political and military wings for a long uprising against the Ba'ath government. As 2012 wore on, the standoff escalated into civil war, with defections from the governing elite signaling the steady collapse of central authority. In recent years, Syria has become increasingly isolated on the world stage, coming under heavy criticism for its role in Lebanon's civil war in the 1970s. Following the assassination of Lebanese former Prime Minister Rafik Hariri, Syria pulled its armies out of Lebanon in 2005, with a UN report implicating Syrian and pro-Syria Lebanese officials in the murder, though this continues to be denied by Damascus. Syria is also accused of supporting insurgents in Iraq. The BBC continues in its report, "Syria's isolation showed brief signs of easing after efforts by France to bring Syria back into the international fold in 2008. But Syria's violation of a UN ban on arming the Lebanese Hezbollah militia led to the extension of US sanctions in May 2010. Further international sanctions were imposed amid the bloody repression of protests in the descent into civil war. By December 2012, the US, Turkey, Gulf states, France, and Britain had recognized the main opposition national coalition of the Syrian Revolution as the sole legitimate representative of the Syrian people, signaling their belief that the Assad government is beyond redemption. The rise of the al-Nusra Front, a radical Islamist militia allied to al-Qaeda, in rebel ranks led to a marked cooling of international and regional support for the opposition in mid-2013 and allowed the government and its Hezbollah allies to launch a counter-offensive. The Assad governments have been among the most intransigent opponents of peace with Israel and have supported several anti-Israel armed groups, most notably Hezbollah and the Gaza-based Palestinian group Hamas. Hopes for Reconciliation have repeatedly foundered over Syria's support for these groups and the vexed question of the Golan Heights. This is modern-day Syria.
Good shepherd, he's laid down his life for his sheep. So out of many nations he's gathered one fold in one faith. And he has built his church on the rock, foundation of faith, on apostles and prophets who shepherd the people in his place. There is one faith, one hope, and one baptism, one God and Father of all. There is one church, one body, one life in the Spirit now given so freely to all. And to all of the 12, the keys of the kingdom, so darkness would never prevail. But some of the shepherds have pastured themselves on their sheep. So he has come out against them and scattered his people of faith. But there still is one faith, one hope, and one baptism, one God and Father of all. There is one church, one body, one life in the Spirit now given so freely to all.
About the Arab Spring, and have all witnessed via the media predominantly the huge repercussions of that movement. But what was it really? Let's listen to Norman McLaughlin from Open Doors share how his passion for the Muslim world was ignited, and also a perspective on the Arab Spring.
When I was a uni student in Queen's University, Belfast, I remember clearly to this day a particular event that happened. It was put on by Youth for Christ. It was called Mission Fest. It was on a Saturday afternoon and then with an evening celebration in Belfast. And they put on this event where they talked about the cause of mission in really every part of the world. And that day it became very clear to me as they outlined what was happening in, you know, Latin America and parts of Asia and Africa and the Middle East and elsewhere, that the most neglected and the most difficult part of the world for mission was the Muslim world. And I remember that day at the evening celebration, you could fill in a little card at the end of the evening where you basically signed your name and said that I'm willing to do whatever the Lord asks me or calls me to do. That day I caught the passion for the Muslim world, and it's never left me. And I've traveled many times to the Muslim world and started traveling from that point, and really have just been open to however the Lord would use me ever since.
I've heard you speak about when you visited Damascus.
Yes.
Could you just briefly share that experience and how you found just meeting ordinary, everyday Muslims on the street and how that impacted you?
Yes. And that was, you know, I just mentioned about catching a heart for the Middle East. And that was back, well, I'll not say how old I am here, but in 1996, which was a few years after this had happened, I had the opportunity to get a free flight somewhere. And I flew into Damascus in Syria on my own with a backpack. And what I experienced for the next 2 weeks was, you know, not a lot of people spoke English, so you couldn't have many conversations as such, but I experienced the tremendous hospitality of the people, because people would just, you know, I'd meet people on buses or in the street or taxi drivers or whatever it might be, or in cafes and so on, and people would just literally treat me as a guest in their country and would invite me to stay in their home for the night, or would make me meals, or would make me tea, or give me drinks. And one night I went and stayed with a family in a village right off the beaten track, and it was the most incredible experience, because this particular family was just a husband and wife with one child. They had a one-bedroom house, and they already had guests staying with them. So the ladies and the one child were sleeping in the one bedroom, and the two men, and then plus myself, slept on couches in the living room, but had a tremendous experience of their hospitality as they put on this lavish dinner. I don't know whether they eat like that every day, but I presume they probably don't. And just experienced throughout those 2 weeks the warmth and hospitality of the people there.
We could learn an awful lot from these people.
Indeed.
Just in regards to hospitality, how to treat the stranger in
yes,
our land.
Indeed.
We have all heard a lot about the Arab Spring. Can you give us a brief summary of what has been happening, and particularly how this has impacted believers in countries like Egypt?
Yes, the Arab Spring began in Tunisia, and this was really the beginning of 2011. Began in Tunisia, spread to Libya, Egypt, and Syria. There were a few of the other Gulf states involved, but they ultimately, the sort of demonstrations fizzled out in those places. But in Tunisia, Libya, and Egypt, in each case, the people were rising up because, you know, economic conditions and so on, and the way social conditions and so on, people without jobs and in poverty and wanting to have a better life and having opportunities in life. So people basically rose up to overthrow their leaders, their dictators, which was obviously Gaddafi in Libya, Hosni Mubarak in Egypt, and Ben Ali in Tunisia. And in each case, those leaders were overthrown and replaced by democratically elected governments. Mm. But in each of those three countries I've mentioned, when the democratic elections happened, the people who got into power were actually Islamists. In other words, those who were democratically elected, who wanted to bring an Islamic regime to countries which had previously been living under much more secular regimes. And so for the people, Muslim and Christian alike, who many of them don't want to live under that, that is what they have now experienced. And so in Libya and Tunisia, that continues to this day. In Egypt, 1 year after the election of Morsi, the Muslim Brotherhood president, he was overthrown, removed by the military, and because, again, he had not delivered on promises that were made to improve conditions in the country, and the people again rose up to overthrow him at that time.
Can you share with us briefly what has been happening in these countries has impacted believers?
I mean, the first one to mention, I'll not go into too much detail. I mean, Iraq in the Middle East, ever since the second Gulf War, which is 2003, so 10 and more years now since that happened, two-thirds of the Christian population have left the country because they've literally been chased out of the country by Islamic extremists. People who've lived for many generations in one place, and all of a sudden they've been thrown out of their homes. We're seeing the same thing happening in Syria, where a huge proportion of the population is now displaced. And I'm talking not just about Christians, but Muslim people, moderate Muslim people as well. And so in Syria, where just 2 or 3 years ago Open Doors was not even active because there was no persecuted church, in 2013, Syria is for us one of the most, the countries where we'll certainly spend the most money in terms of projects that we have on the ground supporting Christians who've been displaced from their homes and literally don't even have anywhere to go or food to eat. So that's Syria. Egypt is a place which, because of what's happened with revolution and counter-revolution, we are seeing now a backlash against the Christian community, which some are saying there is the worst persecution they've seen since Roman times.
I've heard you say quite a number of times that in spite of all this horror and tragedy, there is an incredible movement of God's Spirit.
Yes.
And believers are having amazing opportunities to witness and to reach out.
That's right.
To their neighbours.
Yes. We've seen churches of different denominations who wouldn't have talked before. One of the tragic things in the Christian church everywhere, now coming together in unity to talk to each other and to pray and to stand together. But the other thing we're seeing, as you've just said, is the church is grasping the opportunity of civil war in Syria in particular to say, we now have an opportunity because people are crying out and people are needing something and they're coming to the churches. And they're seeing that opportunity to go out and meet the needs of the people and share Christ with them in practical ways and to point them to Christ as their Saviour as well and to bring that light of the gospel into dark life. So tremendous to see how God is at work even in such difficult circumstances.
So Norman, as we finish, can you share what you believe Christians in countries like Australia can do and what they can do more to support persecuted believers?
Yeah, one of the things, you know, that we say in Open Doors that we're very aware of is, you know, there's many great causes in the world that Christian people should quite rightly get involved in. Many great causes in witnessing for the good news of Christ in so many different situations. But there are situations where non-believers and governments and so on will get involved as well. But when it comes to the persecuted church, no one else is going to help unless we, the church, help. And so my passion and my desire is to see Christians in Australia and around the world, and really our desire is that every Christian in Australia would be aware of the persecuted church and aware of how they can help. To pray, to be informed and to pray intelligently, and we provide resources and materials to allow people to do that. To give to the projects where we can support on the ground, whether it's practical humanitarian support for those, for example, in Syria who've lost everything, whether it's providing Bibles, training leaders, all sorts of different ways.
So what is it like to be a Christian believer in Syria today?
Syria is a country with a majority of Sunni Muslims, but ruled by a non-religious government rooted in a Shia branch, the Alawites. Despite or because of this particular situation, the Christian community, which represents about 10% of the total population, has benefited from a relative freedom of religion.
The situation in Syria for the Christians has always been that there is freedom for them to a certain degree throughout the past days. Christians in Syria truly had the opportunity to worship God freely, to go into their places of worship, like their churches, and nobody will bother them. But the only thing that they had restrictions in is that they were not allowed to go and evangelize in the streets.
But in February 2011, the situation dramatically changed in Syria, leading the country into a civil war. Instead of calling it the Arab Spring, some Syrians are calling it the Arab Nightmare.
After my specialization as orthopedist, I came back with my wife from France to serve my people in Homs. When the turmoil started in Homs, I decided to come in this Christian hospital in order to help the refugees. There was no security in Homs. We were going to work, but after 2 p.m., it was too dangerous to venture out in the streets.
The majority of Christians in Homs were forced to leave, and so they have left Homs and went either to the surrounding Christian valley or to Damascus. But even in some villages in the surrounding Christian valleys, they've been also been threatened and attacked, and so they also had to leave that area and go to Damascus. The church has been rising up because of the support that they're getting from outside to take their place and to reach out with acts of mercy and compassion to others. So they've been reaching out to them with medical help, with food rations, with clothes, with trying to find what the immediate needs they have and trying to reach them with that and provide that immediate need. And they do that for all kinds of background, people from backgrounds, Christian background, Muslim backgrounds, because they don't discriminate and they want to love and reach out to everybody. They don't only reach out to them with food rations and relief work, but they reach out to them with the love of God and with the word of gospel.
Those people, many families, hundreds of families, we are helping people who came from Homs here, families. We are helping families in Homs itself through our church there, especially displaced people who lost their homes and who had to come here, in many cases just in their clothes, and they need everything that you could think of. So the church is going in two directions, trying to do both things at the same time, taking care of what's going on right now and preparing for the great things in the future.
We see how the church in Syria has been fasting and praying for years before this happened. They were fasting and praying for a revival, for changed heart in Syria. And so God's way is different than ours.
You know, it was really a shock for the church to see our country just going through this turmoil. But amazingly, the church responded very strongly. First, it was much more united, and we were united in prayer, and prayer was a major and still is a major activity of the church now. We hear of killing every day, and that hurts everybody. Everybody is really suffering of this. But at the same time, we see many more people receptive to the gospel. We see people having heart to help each other and really doing the relief work in full passion just to reach with the love of Christ.
Did we catch that? The church in Syria has been fasting and praying for years before this happened. They were fasting and praying for revival, for changed hearts in Syria. And so God's way is different than ours. I have reflected on this extraordinary comment made by my sister in Syria. When we talk about revival here in Australia, or indeed anywhere in the West, I am fairly confident that we are not associating the working and experiencing of the Holy Spirit with a bloody civil war. We are not thinking that worsening oppression and persecution of followers of Christ that is unimaginable to us is possibly God's answer to the very prayers that his people have been praying. Isn't revival supposed to happen within the parameters of our expectations, expressed or not? Isn't revival meant to be a blessing? Well, maybe we should start redefining our concept of blessing and returning to the biblical New Testament expression and meaning of it. I would like to read to you from Matthew 5. And seeing the multitudes, he, Jesus, went up on a mountain, and when he was seated, his disciples came to him. Then he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when they revile and persecute you and say all kinds of evil against you falsely for my sake. Rejoice and be exceedingly glad, for great is your reward in heaven, for so they persecuted the prophets who were before you. I don't think we are too excited about Christ's definition of what it is to be blessed. One commentary states, in the Beatitudes, Jesus overturns many commonly accepted social mores and teachings that those who lack are more blessed than those who have it all. Another says, Jesus' message in the so-called Sermon on the Mount challenges us to rethink our values and priorities. He promises rich blessings to the poor, the downtrodden, and the humble, people we wouldn't ordinarily think of as especially blessed. And finally, Jesus turns human social order on its head by stating that it is humility, gentleness, and purity that God truly values, rather than power or wealth. So the Christians in Syria had been praying for revival for years. They are convinced that God answered them by plunging their country into chaos, uncertainty, and civil war. I have been asking myself the question, does Australia need to experience a horrific civil war so that true revival can come to the church?
We see a lot of positive responses. People are not blaming God, saying, "Where is God?" People are asking questions and are much more receptive to the gospel. Even with my fellow doctors, the door is much more open to share the gospel.
I would like to read to you a report from inside Syria. It is titled Revival in Syrian Church in the Midst of Civil War. All the names in this article are changed for security reasons. While the situation in this country is worsening every day, more and more Syrians find God and join the church. This is the revival we have been praying and fasting for years. Pastor Yusuf from Damascus has a hole in each of his pastor suits. It's the result of a bullet going through the house when the family wasn't home. Since the civil war started in Syria, life in the country has become increasingly difficult. The Christians face extra difficulties, being the target of specific threats like kidnapping and violence. Although Syria has a Christian history, Muslim Syrians tell Christian Syrians to go back to their own country. In their view, Christians belong to the Western world. Since December 2012, over 10,000 Christian families have fled their houses. Their neighborhoods are soon taken over by Salafists who rule in Homs and parts of Aleppo with the extreme rules of the Sharia. You see people walking around without hands. They must have stolen something, Pastor Yusuf says. Those who live there are in danger 24/7. With the sounds of war going on around the house, Pastor Yusuf tucks in his two young girls every night, preparing them for what could happen. If a bomb explodes, you might see a lot of blood, and it might hurt a little. But if we die, we will close our eyes here and reopen them in heaven.
When it's all been said and done, there is just one thing that matters. Did I do my best to live for truth? Did I live my life for you? When it's all been said and all my treasures will mean nothing. Only what I've done for love's reward will stand the test of time. Lord, your mercy is so that you look beyond our weakness and find purest gold in miry clay, making sinners into saints. And I will always sing your praise here on earth and ever after. For you've shown me heaven's my true home when it's all been said and done. You are my life when life is done. When it's all been said and done, there is just one thing that matters. Did I do my best to live for truth? Did I live my life for you? Lord, I'll live my life for you.
Although the war in Damascus isn't as fierce as in other parts of the country, people in Damascus too are scared and nervous. They don't feel safe anywhere and stay inside as much as possible. The children check the bins of their schools for bombs every morning before they go in. Yusuf's wife, Hannah, says, "In the midst of this situation, God provides the people with protection. God has saved us many times by showing us the location of bombs so they could be disarmed. The Christians get little support from in or outside the country, but the pastor sees the blessings God gives them through the chaos in the country. If there is no earthly thing to trust in, you have to trust in God, and this is what he teaches us to do through this difficult situation." In this time of sorrow, the church of Pastor Yusuf has been a refuge for many Christians and non-Christians. Women whose men have left to fight in the war come to the church to hear about the gospel. The church saw their prayers for the people of Homs fulfilled in a way they never had expected. We have been praying and fasting for a church of our denomination to open in Homs for many years, Pastor Yusuf explains. But God had other plans. He sent the people of Homs to our church, and the revival is happening right there. They renew their faith in the midst of this crisis. Those who have fled their houses have lost everything, their sources of income, schooling for their children, and any kind of medical help. Open Doors is directly helping the local church in Syria and is strengthening them in order to survive. They hope this will encourage the church to stay in the country. Partnering with local churches, they supply the internally displaced with relief packages and winterization packages. If needed, medical support and help to find shelter is provided. But most importantly, Open Doors encourages the Christians spiritually, providing them with training and Bibles. It's important the church stays in Syria. Hannah stresses, if the church leaves Syria, Syria will be spiritually destroyed. The Christians don't know what to expect in the future. Although the Salafists claim to accept the Christians see a different reality in the country already. We don't agree with the regime, but we fear the Islamic government that might come in the future will be worse, especially for the Christians. The faith of the Syrian Christians is strong. Pastor Yusuf and his family have stopped watching television because, in their opinion, the broadcasters only share lies. Instead, they turn to God every morning to guide them through the day and to provide them with the things they need to know. People in their church follow their example. We get our news from heaven, they say. It gives them peace and strength to carry on. God has saved us so far, so we are still needed, Pastor Yusuf says. If we keep praying, God will do something incredible. This is what we all feel. I would like to share with you now the work and perspective of a youth pastor who has chosen to stay in a war zone because he is convicted that's where God wants him to be. The article is aptly named, God is at Work in Our Country. The noise of bombs, rockets and gunshots are heard in many places 24 hours a day in Syria. Thousands of people are on the run for the violence. But God is at work, we hear several Christians say. Christians that stayed in Syria are also saying, this is a great opportunity God is offering to the church to get out of our church buildings and reach out to the people. Andreas, we changed his name for security reasons, a 28-year-old youth worker of one of the churches in Aleppo, sees the moment in Syrian history as God's grace. We as church were too focused on ourselves, on our own congregation. It seems that we needed the civil war to leave the four walls of our church building and help those in need outside our congregations. Andreas sees Aleppo as the place God wants him to be. But he and his family did also flee the city as the cruel reality of the civil war came too close. A rocket hit our neighbor's house. The explosion damaged our house as well. We already were thinking about leaving because my sick parents couldn't get the medicine they needed in Aleppo. His father, mother, and their six children fled to a coastal city in Syria. We first repaired our house very provisionally, and then 2 months ago we left. For my parents, it is better here. Now they can get their medicine again and they get better. Also, in this city, it is a challenge to get the medicine. Many times I have to search at 10 different places to find them, but at the end I can buy the medicine somewhere. When the youth worker tells about the situation in his country, at times his eyes fill with tears. At moments his voice isn't that steady. But these tears are rapidly replaced by a big smile on his face. I believe and see that God is at work in the country. God made churches come out of their four walls. In the past, we only had our choirs, our activities for the members of the church. Now I see churches reaching out and working together to make a difference in the country. They are coming out of their comfort zone. Thank God that He is using all for His glory. This period is a gift. It is God's grace to us. We now really can deny ourselves. We can evangelize and reach out. Then, lowering his voice, he says, I believe that the church needs the martyrs. Through them, the revival comes. Then Andreas, all of a sudden, sings a phrase of a well-known song. God will make a way. That is what is going to happen in Syria. God will make a way. His way.
Heaven and earth will fade.
But what is the current situation in Syria after nearly 4 years of civil war? Almost daily, we have been hearing and reading about the relentless advance of IS, Islamic State, across Iraq, and the horrific consequences on the civilian population, especially Christians. We have seen the barbaric executions of foreign journalists and watched thousands of people fleeing across the borders of Iraq and Syria. Let me read to you an article from RT.com news page titled "Crisis in Syria, Biggest Humanitarian Catastrophe in the Modern Era." It is dated September 23rd, 2014. The Syrian humanitarian catastrophe is reaching world war proportions, with bordering states incapable of accommodating millions of refugees seeking shelter outside the conflict zone, Director General of the Turkish Red Crescent, Mehmet Guluoglu, told RT. With the escalation of the situation in Syria, both due to the ISIS expansion to Kurdish territory and US airstrikes, the number of Syrian refugees trying to cross the Turkish border has increased significantly. According to the latest estimate from Turkish authorities, the number of Syrian Kurds who have crossed the border into Turkey escaping from Islamic State fighters in recent days exceeds 130,000. For sure, Syria had a number of problems before ISIS came there, though the expansion of this jihadi group into the country has led to further escalation of the situation in some areas, for instance, in the northeast. In general, there are more than 10 million people affected by this crisis, with around 6 million people being forced to move from one town to another and more than 4 million refugees to other countries. According to Red Cross officials, there are only few options for the Syrian refugees. To try to find a kind of safe place within Syria, stay where they are and obey the ISIS rules, or alternatively, to flee to Turkey. Guluoglu told RT, there are only three options. One of them is that they will be an internally displaced person, or IDP. They will go to another place in Syria. Another option is that they would obey the rules of the ISIS, but it is very difficult to live under the conditions of ISIS because if people make even a few mistakes, according to ISIS, they could be killed. That's why the only option for people there is to come to Turkey, and that is why thousands of people go there. Now Turkey is the most crowded country for the Syrian people. That is why the Turkish government probably will let the people go, because from the beginning of the war, the Turkish government used an open-door policy for Syrian refugees. But the solution will not be this, he added. Guluoglu calls for a political solution, as the Syria crisis and even the very reason for the ISIS existence is a result of what is happening between the groups and the regime inside Syria. However, he thinks that the elimination of the ISIS threat would not lead to the end of the crisis, as not all the displaced people will be able to go back, and those who will return will have to start from the beginning since most parts of Syria are destroyed. He says, it will take years for them to rebuild their cities. There are no hospitals, there are no schools, there are no houses, and there are no government buildings. Aleppo was one of the most crowded cities of Syria. Unfortunately, people who went there are telling all the same as reports and humanitarian workers do. They say that there is no Aleppo anymore, and there is no more Homs anymore, unfortunately. A post on Al Jazeera's webpage dated August 2014 and titled "Syria 3 million tragedies, gives a breakdown of the countries where Syrians have fled since civil war exploded in 2011. We read, Lebanon hosts about 39% of Syrian refugees, or over 1,140,000. Today, Lebanon has more refugees per capita than any other country in the world, with Syrians making up about one quarter of its total population. Some 67% of refugees in Lebanon rent basic apartments or homes, half of which are overcrowded with several families. Over 30% live in substandard conditions in makeshift shelters, tents, unfurnished buildings, garages, warehouses, and work sites. Turkey is the second biggest destination country for Syrian refugees, hosting about 28% of them, or over 832,000. The influx into Turkey far surpassed initial projections, and refugees in the country are expected to number 1 million by the end of 2014. About one-third of Syrian refugees in Turkey live in camps along the country's southern border with Syria. Jordan hosts about 20% of Syria's refugees, or just over 612,000. About one in five live in camps, with the largest being the sprawling Zaatari camp in Jordan's north. Zaatari has become the country's fifth largest city because of the influx. But the vast majority of Syrian refugees live outside of camps, mostly in northern and central Jordan. Iraq hosts about 8% of Syria's refugees, or around 213,000 people. Nearly 40% of Syrian refugees in Iraq are hosted in camps, mostly in the northern Kurdish region of Dohuk, while 60% live in local communities. Most are highly vulnerable and live in substandard accommodations. Iraq's own security challenges and the recent rise of the Islamic State group have made the journey across the Syrian-Iraqi border more difficult and dangerous. The vast majority of Syrian refugees in Egypt, who number around 139,000, live in rented accommodations in Cairo, Alexandria, and Damietta. Syrians were initially welcomed to Egypt without visa restrictions, but that changed following the ouster of former President Mohamed Morsi and the military's takeover in 2013. Now Syrians face visa restrictions and stringent security clearance measures, as well as tensions with host communities. An assessment conducted earlier this year found that 49% of Syrian refugees in Egypt were considering leaving the country. And where else are Syrian refugees fleeing to find refuge? Well, about 123,000 Syrians have applied for asylum in Europe since the war began in 2011, with Germany and Sweden receiving more than half of all new asylum applications. About 10,000 refugees, mostly Syrians, entered Bulgaria last year across the Turkish border. Much smaller numbers of Syrian refugees have been resettled in countries such as Argentina and the US. The number of people making the dangerous sea journey from the African coast to Europe has skyrocketed this year, and one factor is the rising number of refugees from Syria. We must stand with our brothers and sisters in Syria as they endure unimaginable circumstances, anguish and uncertainty. We must stand with our Christian family who are right now internally displaced in Syria, fleeing across borders, or struggling to survive in refugee camps. They are not statistics. They are not some newsprint on a page we flick through as we are getting to the sports section of our newspaper. They are our family. We are one body, and when one part suffers, we all suffer. And yet we have seen that even in this extreme hardship, there is joy and victory and revival of the church. This is Helen Motti, For Eternity.
For Eternity.
For Eternity is produced in the studios of Rima FM, Port Macquarie.
Hello, this is Helen Motti, and I want to welcome you to For Eternity.